When it comes down to things as white supremacy and politics, people tend to become quite emotional. And their reasoning is not always based on facts. Well, that's understandable because politics is the continuation of military conflict without physical armors. So, in politics, the conflict of the fallen mind of mankind is played out. Most people never realize this definition of politics. Politics has nothing to do with managing earthly resources. This may sound very dumb, what I'm saying here, but politics has nothing to do with that. Administration has to do with managing earthly resources. And human beings can administer resources by forming groups or by forming institutions. That is not politics. Politics is the field where the conflicts that people can't fight out physically are played out through institutions. So politics is a diversion from direct violence. The alternative from politics is face-to-face or tribe-to-tribe interpersonal conflict. And such conflict will not benefit anyone in the long run. It will only lead to cycles of homicide and vengeance. And for a long period of time, many tribes on the earth function that way. Yet cycles of vengeance and homicide, and that's how generation after generation, the population remains in a state of fear that someday something bad may happen to any one of them. Now you can understand that growing up in a situation where you can be kidnapped anytime and tortured because of something that happened before you were born, that's not an optimal place to grow up in. And if you have adults in a community that grew up in such an environment, it will bring psychological damage with it. So you're going to have a lot of damaged adults in such a case. So what is the alternative of tribal and interpersonal conflict 24/7? That is when you delegate your frustration and your anger to a group of people who act out on your behalf. And that is what politics is all about. If politics was about managing primary resources, then you can say that politics has failed thousands of years ago. Which it has, when it comes to managing resources. So if politics failed thousands of years ago, why is it still around? It's still around because people are still in a fallen state in general. And as long as people are in a fallen state, they need an outlet for their negative tensions. That is why the ancient Romans had circuses. In a circus, you had actors that fought one another, and in many cases, one actor was killed. Or if the crowd showed mercy, the actor was allowed to live, which is quite cruel. So you're an actor, you're going into the field, you're not sure if you're going to make it out alive. And what was the purpose of the circus? Commoners came there and they could choose a side. Let's say you have two gladiators, for example, Maximus and Optimus, for example's sake. And there is one half of the crowd is for Optimus, the other for Maximus. And Optimus and Maximus are fighting, and Optimus is about to kill Maximus. And then Optimus had to wait for the response from the crowd. And if the majority agreed to kill Maximus. He had to kill Maximus, and the people felt relieved. Why? Because they have control. So Maximus becomes the target of all the other people around them that he can't stand. Maybe you have a guy in the crowd who has a neighbor that he can't stand because he is insecure about himself, so he projects that fright onto the neighbor. Maybe there's a woman in the crowd who just cheated on her husband and she doesn't want people to find out. So she wants her husband to be distracted by being upset with someone else. So there are all type of stuff going on. And now, because everyone went to the circus, this whole fight between Optimus and Maximus was this big thing. Everyone was focused on that. And because of that, attention was diverted away from the daily dysfunctions and daily issues. And because attention was diverted away from the daily issues and daily conflicts, now there's more ease in the community and people get along easier. So yeah, you have circuses and you also provide them with an economic bubble. So bread and circuses. You make sure there is an economic bubble. That means that food prices are cheap, so people are fed. So when they are fed, they feel at ease because they are alive. And then you distract them from seeing that their own expectations don't add up. So that is how politics works. You give people some relief in the form of an economic bubble and in the form of entertainment. That is how it always worked. And the Romans were great in this. They mastered it very well. And all the other governments that followed in human history followed Rome's blueprint. Rome's blueprint works, even in areas that we consider failed states. So, knowing what politics really is, and that politics is not the same as public administration, which is the management of earthly resources, we now need to look at this issue of white supremacy from a different angle. We shouldn't look at it from an emotional point of view, becoming upset with people that believe that some race is superior to the other or whatever. Forget about that. Because politics is about diverting negative tension away to prevent societal escalation. That's what politics is about. Politics is a game. And in this game, the actors that are appointed in this game, we call the politicians, they are there to provide false hope to the separate groups in a society so that each group feels validated. Because if only one group feels validated, all the other groups will attack that one group that's being validated. But if all groups feel validated, then all groups will maintain the hope that they'll be vindicated. And if they're not vindicated, they'll extend the fight. And if they have children, it will continue to the next generation. That's how it goes on and on and on. So knowing that politics is a game, and it is an alternative for tribal violence, understand that white supremacy is a defense mechanism. White supremacy is a collective defense mechanism that's used by those pagan authorities that govern this world for two reasons. The number one reason is to keep people away from doing God's will, because they're pagans, so they serve evil spirits, so they worship demons. So to keep people under the grip of evil spirits, they need to divert their attention away from Christ. That's the one reason of white supremacy. And the second reason is to grant narcissistic supply to the world's population. In order to meet those two criteria, there needs to be a population that's blamed. There needs to be a population that's a laughingstock. And blacks have become that target population. It works like this. By everyone looking down on blacks and perceiving blacks as the lowest of the lowest, eventually people begin to treat blacks that way. And when that happens and blacks face a huge amount of difficulties in their daily lives, they shouldn't be there. Individuals, so listen to this, on a collective level, blacks are treated worse. And this will have detrimental consequences for blacks in general, both collective and on an individual level. And the result is that individuals that don't belong to the black community will see the difficulties that blacks endure, and that individual will become frightened by the violence against blacks. So that individual will then look at himself and realize, oh, I'm far better off. And that individual will understand the hidden message that if you want to get along in society, you don't associate with blacks. So the individual will likely conform to society's expectation by associating himself with what society considers the standard. And to validate the standard, it needs to be against blacks. So people will conform to society, whether it's a society in Asia or society in the Arab world or in Europe or Latin America, wherever, they will conform to the local society. And because everyone in that society does not want to belong nor be associated with blacks, that's one thing they all have in common. And because they have this in common, they feel connected to one another. So their social cohesion is based on them not being black. And everyone in that society has that as a minimum security, that they are treated with decency. For example, you can have an Asian guy from Korea, for example, who's from a poor neighborhood. And people from his neighborhood are not considered at all by the rest of Korean society. But when it comes down to it, the Korean people will prefer him, even though he's Korean. He spoke Korean is bad and he has bad manners. Koreans will rather put up with him than with someone from Africa or some Afro-American. And that individual knows that the social cohesion of his society is based on them being accepted by the West. And acceptance by the West means that you're disassociated from Africa. So that individual, even though he doesn't have much to offer to his local society, he still gets a basic appreciation by his community for not being black. And that works as a spiritual bubble that he is not attacked nor harmed to the extent he otherwise would if white supremacy did not exist. So white supremacy offers a minimum of relief from violence for those that don't look like the target group. That is the basic short-term advantage that people get out of white supremacy. That means if you're not black. And it's this basic relief that white supremacy offers that makes it so powerful. Because white supremacy is unnatural. It therefore cannot work in anyone's benefit for the long term. It can only provide short-term relief that has some real benefit or some real value to people on the short term. And it's those short-term benefits, or you can say crumbs, that people cling on to. So white supremacy is a system. It's a system people become dependent on, often without realizing that they depend on that system. Because it works out like this. If you have a group of people that are victimized over and over again, eventually people get used to seeing them being victimized. That's why if there are news messages about Africa, they show you people in very bad conditions. But if something bad happens in Europe or in Asia, or let's say East Asia, they will not show so much disturbing images. There are ghettos both in Europe and in Africa. But in mainstream media, there's this tendency to show all the gore and violence, all the bad stuff in Africa. And when it comes to Europe, they don't show that much. Why? Because the masses are conditioned to see black people in a bad state. By them being conditioned to see black people in a bad state, they now will feel comfortable on an unconscious level when bad stuff happens to black people. So this serves for them to feel relief that they don't belong to the black community. And this is what motivates individuals to contribute to their local societies. And this is how the fallen mind of worldly people work. Worldly people have this black and white way of processing things. So if Africa, where people are dark skinned, if Africa is the laughing stock, it means that the opposite must be good. That's the dualistic black and white thinking of worldly people. So on an unconscious level, they're conditioned to see everything that does not look like black to be better. And eventually they will feel better when they associate with anything that's not black. That's the psychological effect on people. And by using psychological effect on the world's population, let's exclude black people on the rest of the human species. By using this effect on them, people are blinded from seeing reprobation in their own communities. Why? Because they get narcissistic supply from the fact that they're not black. So they feel good being Asian, being Arab, being white, or being whatever label they receive, or being biracial and all of that. So when they feel comfortable being that, they want to preserve this comfort. So they associate with people that look like them. And here's the trap. By them seeing themselves as good or quote-unquote superior, they now cannot admit at the same time that there's reprobation amongst them. Because to admit reprobation amongst them in their communities would mean that their sense of superiority or their sense of security for not being black is based on nothing. If blacks are the bad ones, that means that they're the ones that should have reprobation and all the filth of the earth. To admit that they are filth also would ruin the illusion. And their social relationships depend on this illusion being in effect. So what happens is that through their institutions, so here's where politics comes in, they want to hide reprobation amongst them and highlight reprobation amongst blacks or amongst other groups that look like black folks. And when this happens over time, the people that are not black, that depend on this narcissistic supply, they'll become abusive towards themselves. When there is child abuse going on or child molestation, well, it happens. Those are incidents here and there, but they don't really want to talk much about it because, come on, such things belong to blacks. Look at Africa. They can't take care of ourselves. We're Asian. We're Arabs. We're white. We're Latinos. We know how to manage ourselves. Okay, so if you know how to manage yourselves, then why is there so much sexual defects amongst you? So what happens then is that when child predation comes to the light, they punish the individuals very quickly by putting them in jail, or they suppress knowledge about it so that it appears as if it doesn't happen. The result of it is that the sexual defects are not dealt with, and it begins to grow. Demons get a hold on many people, and before you know it, you have millions of adults sexually confused with bitterness and anger, and this is going to work out very bad in that community. Because the thing is this, if you're associated with perfection, then it means that you don't have to change, and that means that you don't have to self-reflect. Look, even perfect people self-reflect, but self-reflection has nothing to do with whether you're good or not. Self-reflection has to do with functioning in daily life. If you are perfect, you still need to self-reflect if you are driving a car. You need to self-reflect to see whether you manage the car well. If you don't have much experience of cars, then you need to self-reflect, but realize, okay, I don't have much knowledge of cars. Let me look for someone who has knowledge. So self-reflection has nothing to do with sin nor evil or anything like that. It's just a natural thing we ought to do. But worldly people, they are allergic to self-reflection. So when they have this collective stronghold, this collective false imagination that they are valuable because they're not like those people over there. When they have something so powerful to rely on, they don't want this reliance to be disturbed by reality around them. So they generate bubbles to preserve this illusion. And that's how over time, this will lead to societal collapse amongst those nations or ethnicities that are not black. So white supremacy in the long run ruins both blacks and non-blacks alike. Nobody benefits in the long run when it comes to white supremacy. Because white supremacy breeds psychopathy in those ethnicities that are not black, because they don't intervene as much as needed in their communities, because A, they get the validation that they're relevant, and amongst blacks, it can lead to a victim mentality that will feed this whole loop. So nobody benefits in the long run from white supremacy. White supremacy is like a cancer that affected the human species. But this is the type of cancer that people want to admit it for what it is. So, knowing what politics is about, diverting tribal conflict into the public arena, white supremacy is, as I've explained throughout this video, is the collective defense mechanism so people don't have to face themselves collectively. And as any psychologist will tell you, a defense mechanism is just a quick fix so you don't have to really deal with the issue that's going on. And quick fixes work, but they have side effects. Quick fixes become addictions eventually. Think about the individual that smokes. The first time they smoked, it was just to have something to distress their mind. Eventually, they became dependent on tobacco to distress their mind. And now they are smoking for the sake of smoking, because if they don't smoke, they feel bad. The same with the alcoholic. The first time they drank alcohol just to forget about stuff, it worked. It worked so well. So they thought, why not use it one more time? And before they knew it, it went out of control. Every defense mechanism turns into addiction eventually. A defense mechanism is a quick fix to de-escalate a situation, but a defense mechanism is not a solution. Let me repeat that. A defense mechanism is a tool to use to de-escalate a situation for a moment, but a defense mechanism is not a solution to whatever is going on that needs to be addressed. So, in order to, in order to diminish and shut down the impact of white supremacy, it's important to understand what you're dealing with. Too many people have their ideas of what white supremacy is or what racism is about. When you have your ideas that aren't based in reality, but are based on emotions, you'll be contributing to the problem instead of the solution. It's one thing to go in the streets and to protest against police genocide on blacks that goes on in the United States. That's one thing. It's a whole nother thing to understand that it's a defense mechanism that continues because people believe in it. And once you understand this, you will also reflect on yourself and see where you have an investment in it. And that can be quite painful. But the moment you admit this, you are already delivered from the spell. And the less people are deformed by the spell, the quicker the curse will disappear. Because white supremacy is something that both blacks and non-blacks are invested in. A lot of blacks are invested in white supremacy as a target to fight against. And this fight against white supremacy gives them a sense of purpose in their lives. So they are indirect supporters of white supremacy, because without white supremacy, there's nothing for them to fight. And this sense of purpose is gone. That's why many of those black power groups don't succeed in actually delivering positive and long-term benefits to their communities, because it's based on resistance and it's not based on natural ambition. If it's based on natural ambition, it will get things done. If it's based on resistance, it will only give relief. So what can you do on an individual level? What you can do on an individual level is to de-invest from the illusion. Or, let me use actual words, remove your investment from the scam. Because white supremacy is a scam. And as a scam, it remains powerful when people are invested in it. Because this is how the human mind works. The longer you've invested in something, the more that thing you invest in has a grip on you. If you don't invest in something, it can't have a grip on you. Something may affect you, obviously, but just because something affects you doesn't mean it has a grip on you. Something has a grip on you when you are invested in it, one way or the other. On an individual level, you cannot stop white supremacy as a whole. We understand that. So I'm not suggesting you to stop your people from believing white supremacy. That's not something you can do. But what you can do is you can remove your investments from the scam. And when you do that, now you're open for far better. Now you're open to real solutions and now you're open to real prosperity. Because white supremacy is about a false prosperity that appears real. There is not much about white supremacy that's real to begin with, except the violence and the victimization that happens. People have to believe in the false prosperity in order to become blind to its violence. And that is what this white power structure, which is Apollo worship, so it has nothing to do with skin color in itself. It's devil worship. That's why those devil worshippers spend so much time in creating propaganda to trick people into believing in the false prosperity that white supremacy promises. As long as people are invested in this expectation of this prosperity, they'll be distracted from seeing the violence that also affects them. Because remember, nobody benefits in the long run from white supremacy, because it's a scam and it's a very ugly and very dysfunctional scam to begin with. So, are you walking by faith? Because it's when you walk by faith that you escape this trap of white supremacy. Be at peace.